Last but not least, let's talk a little bit about what happens with sex chromosomes, because those are also a very specific type of chromosome that can be inherited. And of course, sex is also characteristic, and the question is, how does that work with Mendelian genetics? It works a little bit different, because sex determination is something that happens at the chromosomal level. It's not inherited per se. It's a characteristic that is a little bit different. And so the first thing to figure out what happens here is to see how sex is actually determined at the chromosomal level. Now, in humans, we already did this. We know already that there are things such as sex chromosomes, and that we as humans have an XY sex determination system in which the males possess the Y chromosome. So let's take a look at this. So a male has 44 chromosomes we call autosomes, and two sex chromosomes, an X and a Y. Now, when a male produces sperm, there are two possibilities. There are either X sperm or Y sperm. And remember what we talked about, that the X sperm decreases when the male ages and so on. And so this is what happens. In contrast, females are XX, and females have only an X chromosome to contribute to this. So any eggs a female makes are only X chromosome eggs, which means that in this situation, the male, because there are two chromosomes, different chromosomes, the male determines the sex of the offspring. And so here you have females, they need the female sperm, the X sperm, and males, male offspring, they require the Y sperm. And so this is how sex determination works in other organisms. There are all kinds of fish and amphibians and reptiles that have XY sex determination systems. And in each case, it's the male that produces the gender of the offspring. There are, however, a couple of different sex determination systems that are pretty neat, and so that's why I mentioned them. For example, in grasshoppers, you have an XO system, or an X0 system, where the absence of a chromosome here, there's only an X, the absence of a chromosome makes you male. So in this case, you have a strange situation where you have 2N equals 23, and that's a male grasshopper. Now, we had an XO system, or an XO instance, when we talked about sex chromosome problems in humans. We had something called XO, and that was called Turner syndrome, where the individual actually had one chromosome less. Well, there, it does make a difference, because the individual isn't a male. It's a female phenotype with some reproductive problems. Whereas in grasshoppers, the absence of that chromosome makes it a perfectly normal male. In chickens and some amphibians and some reptiles, you have something called a ZW system. Now, the people who were studying sex chromosomes, they realized that they had an XY system. And in the XY chromosome system, the person with the two different chromosomes is the male, and the ones with the same chromosomes is the female. And then they observed that in the ZW system, they had the individual with the same chromosomes be the male, and with a different chromosome, it's the female. So clearly, this is a different kind of sex chromosome system. And because they were kind of stuck on the letters X and Y, they went one way. One letter over from the X is the W. And the other way, one way over from the Y chromosome is the Z. So they ended up calling it ZW. Not because it looks like a Z and it looks like a W. Remember that the XY system, that's because the X chromosome looked like the letter X. The Y chromosome looked like the letter Y. Well, they threw all that out and instead said, okay, we'll just go one over from the X, one over from the Y, and that's what we call it. So that's what we're stuck with, the ZW system. Females have the different sex chromosomes, and what's more, it's not only that the females have the ZW, it's also that unlike in the XY, where the X chromosome is big and the Y chromosome is small. In these situations, the Z chromosome is small and the W chromosome is big. One of the things I did is my postdoc, I found the frog that has the largest W chromosome in the world. It is 7 times as large as the Z chromosome. So it's kind of interesting. And, you know, if you think about chromosome numbers and size matters and all that, well, not really. It's just a frog, just got a big chromosome, that's all. It does matter even more when you're talking about some social insects, such as bees, because their chromosome number is important. It's not only which chromosome you have, it's actually the entire set of chromosomes. And you'll find here that a drone, that's what the male is called, right? The drone actually has N chromosomes, N equals 16. And the queen, that's the only real female that goes through meiosis, she has 2N equals 32 chromosomes. And so what happens in this case is the queen produces drones that are literally walking sperm cells. That's all they are. They don't really do anything other than deliver sperm to the queen. And when they do so in spectacular fashion. Literally, when the queen bee starts to swarm and leads part of the hive away and all that kind of stuff, there are drones that hover around the queen, and what they're trying to do is inject their sperm into the queen in flight. That's why they do this. And the way they do it, in order to make sure it reaches the queen, they actually literally inject it very forcefully into the queen, and as they do so, their abdomen explodes. Poof! And that's how sperm is delivered in bees. So in that case, I mean, it's a big party. You go out with a bang, right? That's what happens. The queen receives multiple sets of sperm from multiple drones, and each time the drone delivers the sperm, they blow up and die. Poor drones. Now, when it comes to sex chromosomes, there are a variety of genes on the X chromosome. In humans, and this is what we're interested in here, there are sex-linked genes where the X chromosome, which is of course the larger chromosome, has these genes, and they're entirely absent from the Y chromosome. So for example, when it comes to red color blindness, the gene that creates the rods and cones in the condition that allows you to see color is on the X chromosome. And if the particular allele that you, gentlemen, inherit is defective and does not make the right rods and cones, then you are red-green colorblind. And red-green colorblind means that when it comes to testing you with diagrams like this, you would not be able to recognize the pattern in there because it appears kind of gray and gray to you. And in this case, you would not be able to recognize that this is showing the number 2. Seven. Oh, that's right. I'm just testing you. So it is the number 7. I didn't mean to imply that you're all colorblind, but it's the number 7 in there, and people who are colorblind, they may not be able to distinguish that. So how does this work? How do you have a gene only on an X chromosome, and how do you find out the inheritance behind this? So what we're going to do is we're going to go through these Punnett squares for each of the possible scenarios, and let me explain to you how this works. If you have an entirely unaffected individual, that is the color white. And so this individual would have either 2 X chromosomes, that would be a female, and in both cases you'd have the big N attached to that X chromosome, and that would be normal. Or if you're a male, you also have the X chromosome with the big N and the Y chromosome, and the Y chromosome doesn't have anything. If you are a carrier, then this means that you are carrying the color blindness because you have the little n on one of the X chromosomes. All carriers are female, because if a male has the little n, then the male is colorblind. And then you have colorblind individuals that are female as well. So the question now is, how do you produce each of these genotypes? In the first instance, you start with an unaffected female, unaffected and not a carrier, and you have a colorblind male. And notice here, the little n is what causes this colorblindness on the X chromosome. You do what we always do. You separate these alleles. So you start with this for sperm and with that for eggs, right? And if you then do this Punnett square, what you see is you have a series of female carriers, which is, of course, only possible with females, and you have a series of unaffected males. These males, if they father children, they will never father colorblind children. Why is that? Well, if you look at this one, you can see that if you have a carrier female and a normal father, you're going to get X normal sperm and Y sperm, and you're going to end up with these. So I misspoke. You do have a colorblind individual here, but you're skipping the generation. So from the colorblind back to the colorblind, you're actually skipping one generation where no individual is colorblind. Now, the last thing is, how do you actually get to a colorblind female? Is that even possible? And it turns out it is, but it is only possible when you have a colorblind male and a carrier female. And so when you do this, you can see here is the female colorblindness. Now, one of the questions is, you know, how prevalent is colorblindness? Well, it's not that common in the population. It's not particularly rare. And the reason why it's part of the population is because it's not really something that gives the individual with colorblindness a really serious disadvantage. I mean, think about how society is. If you go on a blind date, colorblindness is not something that you ask each other about, is it? It's not like, are you colorblind? Yes, I'm out of here. We don't do that. And so since there's also no actual mechanism to remove individuals that are colorblind from the population, then colorblindness just persists. I mean, one of the ways you can do this is you can turn the traffic lights sideways so that an individual who is colorblind doesn't know whether it's a red light or a green light. Nah, that doesn't really work. No, they could. So one of the things that, you know, you may say, oh, this is why the traffic lights tend to be, you know, right side up with the red at the top. So it doesn't matter if you can see red or green, as long as the light in the top lights up, then you know that it's the red light. So there is no real effect whether you're colorblind or not, right? So therefore, colorblindness is going to be in the population. It'll be there, and this is how it is inherited. Now, there are some sex-linked diseases where it does play a bigger role, and it is also something where there are some diseases that have really sort of a role ultimately in global politics, and hemophilia is one that I want to tell you a quick story about. In the royal families in Europe at the turn of the 20th century, so in the late 1800s, the early 1900s, you find that most of the royal families in Europe were somehow intermarried and related. And a lot of them were related to Queen Victoria of England. And she had a whole bunch of kids, and they married into good families. And eventually, one of her granddaughters, Alexandra, she married the Tsar of Russia. And they had a child, Alexis, and Alexis was the heir to the throne. They had four girls and Alexis had a recessive sex-linked disease called hemophilia, which Alexandra and her mother and Queen Victoria were carriers of. And this kind of disorder is pretty debilitating, because if you break part of your skin and you start to bleed, then there's no way to stop the bleeding. The bleeding literally gets stopped when the skin mends itself. So if you have a small gash, you just have to keep on bandages and pressure, and eventually it'll fix itself. But the blood doesn't clot. Now, for running around and playing like a child would, this is a bad idea. Especially because it's not only about the outside bleeding, but it's also about internal bleeding. Think about somebody giving you a Charlie horse, right? That's internal bleeding. Right, if you give somebody Charlie horse and there's then the little bit of a swelling and you can sort of have the dark spot on the side of your leg. Well, for somebody with hemophilia, that's internal bleeding and it can become quite significant and quite debilitating. So this person was not able to live a normal life, and as a consequence was, you know, very protected, very weak overall, and of course, this weakened the monarchy. Now, the reason why this is a player in global politics, even to this very day, is because it was a decisive factor in how Russia changed. How Russia changed first from the monarchy to the Soviet Union. In 1917, the royal family of Russia was overthrown. They were all killed, and the Bolshevik Revolution took charge of the country, and Russia emerged as the Soviet Union. Well, when the Soviet Union fell apart, that changed things again, but we still have Russia as a product of what happened during the Soviet days. And President Putin is somebody who came through the Soviet system. There hasn't been long enough of a gap between that system and what's new, and so it appears he has some of those imperial tendencies from the Soviet days. And so this is how this little sex-linked disorder actually has a pretty substantial effect on politics, even yet today. So that's just an interesting illustration, I think. And that's the end of chapter 9.